the moment, I build quite complex modulation. So it affects the pitch and this. I can solve it here because it's visible. The amount of this modulation amount of the spectral details of the sound at the moment.
And what is common brain activity? Was it like splitting in two channels, or is it like an average?
It's two. I have two signals here. And they affect different things here. So basically, the modulation is the one.
Yeah, because sometimes you have clues one to the other, so it's difficult to understand who is doing what.
Yeah. And of course, we're sharing also some signals, so
yeah,
things are also changing in the same way. Which of course is it's kind of nice.
Yeah, I try to play along. So
yeah. Here I was. So it was. Yeah.
Should we do some rock and roll?
Yeah.
A guitar.
I can. We can feed in the guitar sound and also modulate that with the brain. Find some cables and hook you up to the synth and then try to change filters or things like this with brain activity.
Mm-hmm.
Just an idea.
That's how to do that. I just took my sound and it's coming out from the mixer to the PA.
The FX out?
Yeah, it's going to mixer now.
Yeah, it will take a while for me to find the plugs in the dark.
Yeah,
so that's any suggestions? Anybody wants to hear something or look at something? Try something out. Be connected.
Can I ask something?
Yes, of course.
I'm curious about the role of surroundings in your work. I mean, you seem to be like a closed and open ecosystem at the same time, because you have been working together many years, as you said,
mm-hmm.
but then at the same time you're seeking like out for collaboration wherever you are and perform. And because at least now from this session and me being not an expert, from my observation you seem to have a high control of the processes and the bits and the pieces. You seem to, at least. You seem to control quite a lot. And I'm curious are you welcome? I mean, you're welcoming the surprise in this constellation?
Yes,
and is it often that it's happening? And if so, like, was there any surprises in your today's jam?
Basically, it's the chance we have is like this journey that from since yesterday, I think it's maybe the first time we have the impression of controlling a bit more than we used to do before, because most of the time we were always using alpha, and alpha it's you need to get into this kind of meditative state, and it's difficult to, it's a non-controlled state. And now
so
that
by default you don't control that.
Yes.
Yeah.
But now that we have like five, six,
four
different frequencies, like not only alpha. So it means we can also switch from attention to non-attention. So I can open my eyes, for instance, and then it will really have an effect and I can hear it. So that's why we're now trying new things, because for instance, being wired together on the same gear, like him doing the pitch and me doing it's audible for us.
So you are aware of what we
spent years not really being aware, and being aware that we affect something, but if you are too aware, you stop your alpha. So you have to be into the sound. It's the really first time that we can play with both aspects, like getting in like totally, and then trying to have a control or it's not really a control, but we can, it's like a switcher.
I often have the sense of, I don't know, control is not the, but it's like going where I want to, and the moment I become aware of that it's going the way I want to, it jumps somewhere else.
Mm.
So there's this kind of on.
But do you allow it to happen, or because you allow it to happen, it jumps somewhere else, or without you necessarily?
But the more you train, the more
you
can also allow it to happen.
It's, but I like very much this sort of softness of control. It's like this. It's for me. It's so much about that. It's about this weird kind of control, non-control, because it's very much, for me, it becomes metaphysical. It becomes the way that in life, the moment you think, okay, now I know what I'm doing, it's like everything derails, and it's a little bit like that on a micro level.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking about the element of surprise and how big role it plays in your work and in your constellation all these years.
But it's also the question whether your belief that you are doing what you think you're doing, whether that gets you somewhere as well. So it's also this sort of, sometimes you have, I'm under the impression that I know that I'm doing, but then something else proves me wrong, like later. So it's also this sort of telling yourself, and all of a sudden there's a thought that pops up that's like, you know, this is ridiculous, or you know, it's like this. There's always this ongoing processes of awareness, of losing awareness, of going into some kind of trance, being pulled out by a noise, by something happening, and it's
or a sound you dislike.
Yeah. Or a sound that you first dislike that you start to like and following, and so it's.
It's also a because nothing's ever the same twice, right?
Yeah.
A very, very different every time. And so you have to kind of prepare for that surprise. And then you're looking for the lucky surprises. So when the two of them are sort of in sync and modulating things that are, you know, and that's the moment where you're like, oh, at one moment I was like, I tried to patch something and then it started happening. You know, it's like, okay, so this is the moment, you just don't touch it and you let it happen, whatever's happening.
So is it you that gets more surprised?
I'm getting very surprised all the time. Yeah. So I don't know.
But you get always fooled. I mean, when this stopped, I didn't notice because I thought that that this sound movement, I thought I was part of it, you know. But actually, I didn't do anything for 5 minutes. So,
No less. But yeah.
So it's.
But I think that is also the interesting thing, is the collective nature of it, and the way that you never know quite where it comes from and it comes in, and there are moments of clarity, or at least belief of clarity or impression of clarity, and the way that it's really, because that is so much the, I think, the foundation for whatever improv, or is this thing of just sort of okay.
Also, it's a matter of aesthetic. We're interested in experimental music, so surprise is not really a fear.
Yeah, obviously, you're open to experimentation. You are ready for any kind of surprises. But as I said, I mean, based on my visual of the situation here, like visual impression of the situation and how, each of you, of course, has an area of expertise, and you know what you're doing, and the cables and everything that you're controlling,
Yeah,
so
if, but they also have maybe the faces of their consoles actually go like. That would be great.
We have to practice on that.
But another thing is that I don't think that there is a one-to-one mapping between the brain state and some kind of subjective state, right? So there is one with alpha, it's very clear. With beta, there's a matter of control, there's a matter of awareness. I actually did my PhD on this awareness of attention using these alpha waves, and so I know it's there, but I also know it's only partial there, and a lot of fluctuations that are, for instance, coming in the synth have not directly, let's say, something to do with their subjective experience. So there is what?
I stop it.
Sorry. Yeah, if you want, but it's good. So there's also something coming out, or something is causing the fluctuations that we're measuring, that has nothing maybe to do subjectively. But then once it gets in there, and it gets sonified, suddenly there's this. It gets fed back into the brain. So So there's a lot of unconscious things, if you like, that play a role. And when they come up, either via the sound or via some intrusion, I don't know. The definition is a surprise, right?
It's the first time I found that we were complementary in a way, because most of the time we play separately,
true.
Like one on a modular and the other on the other, and it's more how we can dialogue. But today was more like okay,
yeah.
We are the same thing. So, but one is X and the other is Y, you know.
Mm.
That was kind of strange to feel that.
Yeah.
Actually, that you hear the two signals, two X and Y.
So you did it.
Yeah.
Do we have time to wire two people?
We can. What's the time now?
I don't know. It's.
No. Just kind of our moments.
Yeah, okay, yeah, well,
past nine.
No, we can do it. And then.
If anyone's interested, try it out. To be part of the performance.
Hey, thanks, Roger.
Hey.
If not, that's fine too. We can also.
Do another.
Round. Yeah, or we can. I don't know, it depends what you want to do, but for instance, what was very nice was the two people at the same time. I have these LEDs here on the left and the right, and from top to bottom it's different frequency bands from Samon and then from Per. And so I was also able to kind of see whether or not there was some kind of, not only here, but also see if some kind of synchrony between the two. And sometimes one was going up and down and the other one was really changing the frequency bands, and sometimes it was the other way around. I know we can attach one person. But if only we're not going to force it on anyone.
I can try.
Can I first ask about the current brain operators? Like how much are you into meditation or this kind of things?
I did my PhD on it. It's on meditation and attention.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So I think it's where, and I also know to speak for Paris that via this, these practices over the last couple of years, he's become very interested and very sort of controls
it. Practiced meditation more during this also?
Yeah.
And is that something that you try to do here also, subconsciously getting into this?
It's different. It's different each time. I mean, I've tried. I mean, what I've noticed, for instance, is that the first day that we do this, because we all live in different places,
mm-hmm.
so the first day I do it, it's difficult to get in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The second
yeah.
day, it becomes easier.
Yeah.
And so on the first day, meditation and relaxation becomes more important, but like
yeah.
today, it's the third day in a row that we
mm-hmm.
play, so I feel more confident and also, but breathing, I think, is like the first, whatever improvisation that we did today was very much, I think, about the breathing and the way that I felt that we were breathing in synchronicity. But you probably saw it more than more than we did. So for me, it's absolutely important. But it's also something that I would, when it works, you go to another level.
Yeah.
Just like when in meditation. When it's really good, you're somewhere else.
Yeah,
but it really depends on the context. So if you have time to prepare for this or not, you know, and
like if you're nervous,
today you were kind of prepared for this.
But we have a different approach because I'm not using at all meditation for this. I'm trying to find ways to lock in.
Can you turn around? So
and sometimes it works.
So when
I depress more and more.
I use a little bit of alcohol.
In
shoot
training,
in the back,
you find trick
alcohol.
Yeah.
And then
and
I will
like
put
looking at
the
eyes closed.
There.
Mm-hmm.
Is
there's not
annoying
it's
enough.
Here,
to
so it's
kind of
it's perfect. It's good. This is where the alpha comes from. So
you want to try or
go for it?
We have to.
Let's see if we can spray.
Yes,
exactly.
We have two people now, so we have to.
But I hope we don't break them.
How much is there like a difference between different people?
Well, it's very obvious things. I mean, one of the subjective elements, like how much do you like the music, how deep can you go? But then, for instance, very specifically, there are also different, the alpha peak, for instance. So we can sort of zoom into the frequencies that are important, like the alpha. And the peak is just different between people.
Yeah.
So one might be at 8 hertz, some might be at 12 hertz.
So that's one of the things that I'm actually also monitoring during the performance, see whether we're properly zoomed in on the performers.
So do you have the different bandwidths sort of different frequencies mapped on like visually on your computer?
Yes. If you want, you can have a look once we have everything hooked up again, and then
I
can.
I would like to see that.
Yeah.
Did you know where the tape?
Yeah, I have the tape. A piece of tape. Or a small piece?
No, too big. No, those are both too small. No. Oh, it's paper.
Yes, it's my tape. Your tape is there on the thingy. Can I have my tape back then?
So yeah.
The same way as everyone has his own alpha frequency, we also have our own frequency tape.
Yeah. After doing hundreds of patients or people, you develop your own style. And my style is typically not to be too gentle. That helps scrubbing and pushing.
I am more gentle. So
he is more gentle. So yeah, you're the lucky one here. Right?
Thank you. Yeah, I try to make it like a full sound.
And I just use some tape to keep it in place. So when we pull off this piece of tape, you might pull a hair. But so la vida. Guinea pig.
So alpha waves starts only when you are really.
I'll just fiddle around a little bit, okay?
Yeah.
Just see how to.
It's also a matter that the other frequencies they go down.
Yeah.
So, for instance, if you would. I mean, we have to mention the first the first artist who were using this, Alvin Lucier. He was he just recorded. He was recording brain activity, or actually his collaborator was, and they bandpassed it in the alpha, and then just amplified it enormously and drove some speakers. So you get the sonic effect of the rattling, if you like, of the speakers, because it's too low to really listen to. Yeah, something. It's a bandpass filter on the EEG, all of course analog. We are having these digital devices now, but
there
then we're using it again for analog sound. So
there was some percussion instruments, if I remember correctly, that Alvin Lucier used.
What?
Percussion instruments.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So he put the speaker in against a gong or against a drum. He also
did. Didn't he have like? Grains or stuff like that on a drum?
Perhaps. We also had like tape machines, actually, I learned only later, that were running with pre-recorded EEG slowed down on tape. Also a smart way of, sped up to make it audible. And then these boxes that you see, the device we buy, but then the boxes are, Robert's 3D printed. And so we have this, this is the new one, the new version, nice and robust, you can put it on your arm. This is a bit more fragile. So.
Sorry, which one is the 3D printed?
This is a 3D printed one, it has the same, has more or less the same electronics inside,
but the
battery is much more robust. It just has an on-off switch, and it uses standard connectors, so we can use this much more flexibly with different types of electrodes.
Okay.
I forgot to ask about the side effects. after this.
You have to warn us. Now it's
you're gonna feel
nice
nauseous for about 3 weeks.
Don't say that. I mean, I've had people come into the lab and go back and call me a week later. Like I felt very strange after your experiment. Did you?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. No, people.
Petri, I blame it on you.
Of course, it's me.
You're responsible.
Yeah.
How long time you have to sit and until the alpha waves start to?
It's very different.
Yeah.
Yeah. The most important thing is to close your eyes.
Mm-hmm.
There's a sort of a physiological mechanism that
mm-hmm.
starts to happen. And when you close
throughout
your eyes,
the
yeah, you
I'm
stop
curious,
your visual input.
Robert, how has it been over the 3 days? Is it did it change?
Yesterday was better.
Yesterday,
so yesterday I would say there was like more clear peak.
Yeah.
Today it fluctuated more. This is also a bit more a noisy environment.
Yeah.
So the quality of the EEG here is not as good.
But the first night it was not good at all.
So
right?
The first night in the apartment. So the first night was in the apartment. There, the signal quality was just not very good.
Okay.
Then at Aalto University, signal quality was actually quite okay. Here the signal quality is like okay-ish, but it really makes a lot of difference doing this in the laboratory environment. Where you don't have wires running everywhere, because all of these wires are causing noise, which are being picked up by the electrodes.
Yeah, it's a very noisy, also with the transmission of the Bluetooth, the Wi-Fi. It's on the edge.
Yeah.
But what about movement then? Because you were moving,
was
not moving.
Yeah.
Usually it's the other way around.
That's but that's also why we're using the headband to make sure that the electrodes don't move. And of course, there's still a little bit of an effect of the movement. That's why we tape them, like why you tape them on your back.
But you get the signals basically through this band.
No, not through the band. It's just that the band makes sure that the electrodes are moving along with your head,
uh-huh.
and that so that because otherwise the electrodes would be pulled, like you would pull if you would move your head.
So
where?
this is the ground, no?
Yeah.
What? Where?
This one here.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And then you have. These two, I think, on one side.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have. Isn't there five? No.
There should be five, yes. There's two. There's three at the front and two at the back.
They're not using the second, just
Oh, yeah, here. And these two.